everyone, welcome to Watch It Paint It. This video we're going to be painting Schmetterling, that's a villain from Arcadia Quest by Simon Games. Now this was a request by Phil on my Patreon, and just showing the dedication here, so you get to see me. If nobody knows what I look like, that's my face. And it's -4 degrees and a good foot of snow outside when I went out to prime this. Now I wouldn't recommend priming in the snow or the cold. It didn't seem to come out that well, but on the model, just demonstrating here, it has applied quite well. That's going to do perfectly well for the primer on that. That was using Dragon Red by Army Painter. That's a colour primer they have. We're going to be on to painting next, and this is starting with Dark Fleshtone. That's a dark brown by Vallejo, and that's going to be to do his loincloth around his waist. Now hopefully you can just see in the video, that's using one of these value brushes by Quickdraw Supply, a link in the description below. But these brushes are sort of 10 cents a piece. They do not cost a lot of money, and we're starting to make the most of them when it's a big area that you don't need a lot of accuracy and you're just sort of jabbing paint on. It's really nice not to use your expensive brushes and make them last a little bit longer with this sort of technique. Desert Yellow is next, and that's going to be painted on his wristbands. You saw some of that dark flesh tone. His sort of wristbands are two-tone, so some of it's dark flesh tone and some of it's this desert yellow on top. So just judge that by eye and look at the art, or you know, follow along with this video and work out which bits to do which. It's a little bit difficult to tell. Sort of the dark flesh tone is under this desert yellow that's on top. And if you haven't noticed, these are not my hands. Although I did the priming, I did the hard bit in the cold. This is Benson painting here, so do big up Benson. Leave him a comment below if you've enjoyed this video. Give him a thumbs up, that sort of thing. Now this desert yellow is also being applied to his sash that's running across or wrap. It's sort of, strap. That's holding on that big sack on his back full of body parts, full of bones. He's collecting bones. So also going to paint in the sack with the strap. I think it's an all-in-one sort of item. So that's all in this desert yellow, which is a pale brown, very pale brown, very similar to the goblin skin that came in the Army Painter's kit, as I mentioned in some of my videos. It was exciting to get an Army Painter version of this sort of tone. Charred Brown's next, that's the dark brown by Vallejo, and that's going to be to do his club. So all of the club except the bottom, which is gold, and we're going to be painting in those spikes in a different colour as well. We're also going to use this charred brown, although it looks semi-black in the artwork. Brown's just a lot nicer to work with, and this is a really, really dark brown. So we're also going to paint in his mohawk, and he's got a little tiny tufty beard as well at the bottom. After that, it's going to be Dead Flesh by Vallejo. That's a sort of dead flesh colour, a little sort of even paler version of that desert yellow. And this is going to be to paint in all of the bones and body parts that are in his sack on his back. So just giving them a nice coat of this dead flesh. Also, while we've got it out, we're going to be doing those spikes that are coming out of his club with a base coat of this dead flesh. You can see that we've now switched to using the Army Painter brushes that I use, so going up a notch in the expense level. So once we need a little bit more accuracy, so we're using a little bit more expensive brush, but still, you know, that's an old brush, not still trying to get some mileage out of it, sort of thing. And then finally, for his teeth there, we're going to be using the same colour but a more expensive, more accurate brush. So really just trying to get the most out of all of our brushes. Here it's bright gold being applied to that sort of loop or ring that's on the bottom of his club. So a little splash of gold there. Warlord Purple is Benson's choice to paint in his tongue. That's a bright purple by the Army Painter. Not by the Army Painter, by Vallejo. I think it's too bright. I would probably use something like Toxic Boils by the Army Painter. Just tone that down a little bit. But we can do that with wash in a minute. And let's see how it does come out at the end. So Benson's going to do some shading next. So we're going to be using Deep Shader. That's the very dark brown shader by the Army Painter. And this is going to be to shade his club, his loincloth around the front. And is it down the back as well? Yeah. It's down the back. And also that bag of bones. So all the bones and body parts that are just in his sack. So make sure you get plenty in there and really fill in the shadows in those bones. It's also going to be doing the Schmetterling's mouth as well. Get that nice and dark around his teeth. Then Zombie Shader's next. That's a slightly lighter brown shade by the Army Painter. And this is going to be to do his sack on his back, as well as that sort of strap that's around his torso holding in that strap. Then jumpsuit shaders next. That's the sort of red shader by the army painter, and that's going to be doing all of Schmetterling's flesh, just giving that a nice dark red shade. So it's going to, most of this work is going to be on the skin of Schmetterling. As you can see, he's a huge big troll with lots and lots of flesh, so it's going to be a lot of highlighting up the skin. So starting with a wash that's a similar color is just going to darken it enough in the shadows to give it some depth, but not too much that it's going to be too difficult to highlight back up. So on to highlighting next, and Benson's going to be starting with dark flesh tone. That's the base color we used on the loincloth. It's just going to be painting back in the base color on all those raised bits, just leaving the shade in the recesses. And we can just take a minute to notice that Benson has nudged my craft mat, my cutting mat underneath, so it's just slightly ajar on camera. It probably doesn't bother any of you, but you cannot imagine how much this has bothered me during the editing of this video for that to be off center. I find it very agitating. It's quite weird. Anyway, for the next highlight of the loincloth, he's going to take that dark flesh tone, mix it with some plague brown, both by Vallejo, about 50-50, and then he's just do some edge highlighting along the folds, the very tips of all of those folds on the loincloth. And you can see he's also just catching those bits of leather that are under his, the straps around his wrists as well. You can see sticking with the Rosemary and Co. brush, the more expensive brush that we use. And I think this is quite a good video to show you how to get some more extra mileage out of your brushes. Use them when it's less important, especially on a big model like this. You don't need the super accurate brushes. You can just use a 10 cents brush. But once you get into the detail and you're really going for that edge highlight and you want a really fine sort of point on your brush, that's when you should be busting out your better brushes. Desert yellow is out, and that's going to be highlighting all of the previous desert yellow bits. So the straps around his wrists, as well as that strap along his chest holding his bag on. And then he's also just going to go around the lip of the bag, the very top where the light would be catching it the most, and just give that a really, really strong highlight back in this color. And once he's done that, he's going to switch again brushes back down to my army paint, which are really, really old, and he's going to effectively dry brush the sack using that brush. So that's a really good example of when to switch brushes. It's quite weird he's not using my dry brush to do this, but he's effectively dry brushing this on, and then dead flesh in the same way across all of those body parts that are hanging out in this Schmetterling's bag. What is a Schmetterling? I feel like isn't that butterfly in German? Something like that, right? I think. And then dead flesh mixed with white primer, just lightening that up. Any white will do, but this is Vallejo's mixing together. And then that's just to do some extra highlighting along the edges of all those body parts. Then Beasty Brown's going to get mixed with dead flesh. You can tell Benson's here, all the colors are getting mixed, all custom colors, but it's a great way of keeping the tones very similar. And then, so as I mentioned, Beasty Brown and dead flesh there mixed together and painting the base of those spikes coming out of his club. And then he's going to be using dead flesh to highlight up towards the edges, towards the point on each of those spikes. But as I'm sure you're quite used to, it is Benson, so there'll be another highlight. We're going to mix some white primer with that 50-50, getting an even brighter shade of that colour. And that is to do the tips and just blending that down. All of these will be quite wet, so he's almost wet blending, but the paint dries so quick, it's not quite. But he'll be making sure they've got a nice smooth transition. And then applying that colour also, it's just edge highlighting all of Schmetterling's teeth, just get bringing some color back into that as though the light's catching the tips of each of his teeth, plurals. Warlord Purple, just going to highlight back up that tongue, just catch any raised parts of his tongue and just make it look a little bit more lifelike inside his mouth. And I did say I think I would have used toxic boils, but that does look quite good on a sort of cartoony troll. Does give a bit of brightness to it. And then bright gold, Benson's going to paint him in a couple of gold teeth, so one of his incisors and then one of those bottom front teeth as well, just giving him a little bit of bling, making his teeth look a little bit more exciting. Charred Brown's going to get mixed with Beasty Brown, about 50-50. And this is to highlight up his big club. And to some extent, you sort of just dry brushing this across. You've got a little bit on your brush, using the side of your brush. Again, you can see lots and lots of swapping of brushes. That's back down to that value brush I mentioned at the start. Obviously, this isn't super accurate. You're just using the side of the brush. You're just trying to highlight up all the raised bits of the club. There's no point wearing out any of your nice brushes. Once that's done, he's going to be doing his hair as well, just catching all the strands of hairs, just side on again, just making those pop out a little bit. And then an extra highlight to all of those bits. This time he is using my dry brush and just very, very lightly catching the club and his hair as well, just adding a bit of brightness on the very tips. Then he's going to be starting to highlight up the skin. He's going to be using Abomination Gore. That's a near match to the Dragon Red that I primed in originally. I'm not sure it is a perfect match though. Somebody can let us know in the comments. But it's certainly close enough, and if anything, it's brighter. So it is like stepping up the highlight. And once again, I've mentioned it a few times, you can see Benson's gone down to that value brush again. I think the reason I keep mentioning it is I just sort of poo-pooed value brushes for a couple of years now. Like, why would you ever use a value brush when you can just, like, the difference in price isn't enough that it's worth not having a decent brush? But having got some and getting used to it now, just swapping between them, I can see how it's really, really, really going to add some mileage. If you can do 20% of a model each time with a value brush, something big like this, you're just taking a load of wear out of your nice brushes. There's no risk of sort of losing the point on the tip of your nice brush as quickly if you can do some of it with this. Now, this value brush, we've only used it 5 times or so, and it's already sort of got a curl on its point. So I can see why you wouldn't want to use value brushes for a lot, but you know, the accuracy in this isn't that important, so it's nice to get a bit of mileage out of your better brushes. So he highlighted all of the raised parts there in that Abomination Gore very, very generously, just leaving the recesses with the shading. And also, this will be heavily, heavily watered down, so this is going to blend very, very well. Then he's going to mix in some Bloody Red. That's by Vallejo. So we're cross-branding it now, and we're just going to be going around the same process, the same areas, just as always with the skin, just moving closer and closer towards the center of the muscles, just trying to lighten it up as the muscles sort of protrudes from the character, and we're just adding less towards the edges of the muscle. Do make sure you're watering down these paints when you're doing this highlighting level. It will let them blend a lot more smoothly. You can always add extra layers of a certain color if you don't think it affected it enough, but this is the biggest, most important part of the model. He's a lot of skin. It's really taking time of blending those nicely and getting a smooth transition between each highlight, especially if you're following along with this, because Benson's going to go a third highlight, and believe me, this will not be the last. Bloody Red just neat now. So you can see we stepped Abomination Gore, stepping it into Bloody Red, about 50-50. Then we're on the other side of that, we're onto this Bloody Red. They were quite close to begin with anyway, but that 50-50 step in the middle is a really, really nice transition. It's really going to make the skin look real, and you barely notice the change in the colors, which doesn't really matter because obviously you see it at a distance, so don't worry too much about the transitioning. But if you can do it good, why not do it good so it'll look nice up close as well. After Bloody Red's done, so again, just all the muscles just less and less moving towards the center each time. But after the Bloody Red's done, it's going to be onto Bloody Red mixed with Hot Orange. So this is now an orange, but that orange is going to brighten up that red. If you use white, you're going to get pink. Orange is going to give you a brighter red. And that was the final highlight on all the edges of all of his sort of ears, his eyes, and the center of each muscle, his fingers, that sort of thing. Then white primer's out. This is going to be to paint him in a couple of eyeballs. And then Escorpena Green. It's so weird, Vallejo is the only one that's not translated, which should be Scorpion, or I don't know why it's not. But that's to give him a pair of irises, one in each eye. And then after that, dead black, just a teeny tiny dot in each eye. You can see using the Rosemary & Co. brush here, making sure we can be as accurate as we can with a brush with the best tip that we've got. White primer's just going to be used to add in a little sparkle to those pupils that you painted in, so an even smaller one just off center, make it look like his eyes are catching some light. Once I've varnished this, I will be adding some gloss varnish to his eyes just to make them look a little bit wet, a little bit more lifelike, so that'll be a step I do off camera. And then Benson's gone home because, again, he's in remission. He's afraid of circles once more. I don't know how it's come on. I think too much teasing him about it, and it just brought it back on. So I'm having to do the base once more. Mournfang Brown was the base coat of the base. And then I'm going to use some Agrellan Earth, as I've done with all of my Arcadia Quest models. They've all got the same base. Applying this really, really, really thickly. You can see I'm using my army painter brush here, so I want some accuracy. But also I'm using an old brush because this isn't great stuff, and you can't be that accurate anyway. It's quite hard to control, but you want to be applying it sort of half a mil thick. I've never done it too thick. To this day, I've never put on too much, but I have put on too little. So I try and put on loads and just try and get it as smooth and even as I can, but it really doesn't matter because it wants to be sort of uneven ground. And here's Schmetterling completely finished. Now it did take about an hour and 42 minutes, quite a long time for us, but still not too bad. And I think he looks pretty good for that. I think Benson's done a really, really, really great job with that skin transitioning. He's really taken his time with it. It's the biggest part of the model. It's sort of all the model really is. I think it's the focal point, and sometimes it's important to pick a focal point and really try and get that bit to look best. So if you did enjoy the video, do big up Benson. He worked pretty hard on this, and leave him a comment below, give him a thumbs up. Thank you all very much for watching. And then just fine, I just wanted to show you this artwork. This is from Shelley. She's one of our Patreon members. She's been painting Arcadia Quest alongside us, and she submitted this to us beforehand. And first of all, I just want to say how great that looks. And I think the skin's completely different to how Benson's just done it, but it still looks really, really good in a completely different way. It almost looks like he's holding a torch to some extent, and these really, really bright highlights. I bet that looks absolutely fantastic on the game table. Benson and myself both loved how that flesh has come out. Incredible work. And the other thing I noticed with this is it's a massive sort of encouragement for Benson to do extremely well in the videos, because he never wants to do a video where somebody's already painted the model better than he can without the tutorial. So everyone keep that artwork coming in. Thank you all very much for watching.